In this session, we will try to understand what are basically class diagrams. We will try to understand the fundamentals of it. We'll try to see different types of classes, like abstract class or interfaces. How can they be represented using class diagrams? And see the same that how we can implement them in the technical documents. Class diagram basically form one of the very basic entities for technical documents. As I said previously, that some of the diagrams are compulsory and very much needed to describe any technical architecture. Like one of the diagrams which we discussed previously was a use case diagram, which is very, you can say, a building block to gather requirements. In the same way, class diagrams are basically very useful, you know, to understand the static part of a project. When we look at any technical architecture design, there are two ways of viewing it. One is the dynamic part of the project and one is the static part of the project. Or we can say the static architecture of a project and the dynamic architecture of a project. To give you a better understanding of the static architecture and dynamic architecture, we'll try to map the same with a real example. When any civil engineer basically builds up architecture, he can probably define the static architecture saying, okay, that this will be the pillars, this will be the beam, this will be the probably the rooms, the sizes, the length, and etc. But what happens if suppose people start living inside it, and then, you know, people start they start staying inside the building, or they start traveling over the bridge, or whatever kind of design, or whatever design for which it is made for. So in the sense, that is a dynamic part of the project, or we'll say when actually it comes into creation. So we can say one is a static architecture of a project and one we can say a dynamic architecture of a project. Both of these views are very important when we write a technical document. So class is, I'll just revise these basic definitions. If you have already done object-oriented programming, then you don't need to really look into this. But in case not, you know, we will just revise the basic definitions. So it is basically a prototype which helps us to create objects. So you can say it's like a data type, and by using the data type you can create objects. As I said previously, they define the static part of a project. They define a blueprint, and from that blueprint objects are created. In UML, the UML notation to define a class diagram is basically by defining a simple rectangle, as I shown in the above video, and then dividing this rectangle into three parts. The first part is where you define the class name. Like example, here the class is CLS customer, so I've defined it as CLS customer. So that is a class name for the class what you are trying to define in using class diagram. The second section consists of properties for the classes. So I have two properties here, customer code and customer name, and also I can define the data type. The third one has the method names. So for example, I have an add customer here, and the add customer basically returns a boolean value. So class, there are three sections. The topmost section is which represents the class name, second section represents the attributes, and third section represents the methods. So whenever you draw the class diagram in your document, or whenever you try to express your class diagram in a design document, this is the UML way of notation, or UML way of defining the class diagram by the three sections. The other important part in class diagrams are basically how are the entities, like either the properties or the methods, exposed to the external world. That's represented by using the plus sign, the hash, and the negative sign. Plus sign indicates that any client who creates the object of this class, like example CLS customer, which I've shown in the current example, will be able to see the customer code method. He will also be able to see the add method. He will be able to see the customer code property and the add customer method. So why? Because they are public methods. So the plus sign indicates that the property or the method is public. The hash sign indicates that it's a protected property. Means what? The classes which inherit the CLS customers will only be able to view those properties and the methods. So it is protected. So you can only see these properties and methods when you are inheriting the class. So you can say that the protected methods and properties are only viewed in the inheritance chain. the final property or the final what you call as the final level of, now that we have understood the fundamentals of how to represent a class diagram in UML by using the three sections, where we defined in the first section the class name, the second section the property, and the third section the method name. But how do we represent these entities, that is the properties, the methods, as public, private, or protected? In order to express these methods or express their visibility outside the class to the client world, we use some notations. For instance, a plus notation before the property or before the method name indicates that this is a public method or this is a public property. So if any client creates the object of the CLS customer, he will be able to call the customer code property, or he will be able to set or get the customer code property depending on how the property is exposed, and also he will be able to call the add customer method. The negative sign before the property or the method indicates that this is a private entity, or this is a private property or a private method. So customers or clients, I'll say, not customers, sorry, clients who create objects of CLS customer will not be able to view the net profit property. So it is encapsulated and it is protected from the outside world. The in-between property, that is we can say the in-between visibility is called as the protected visibility. The protected visibility is defined by using the hash symbol. So if you define the property or the method using the hash symbol, it can only be viewed by classes who inherit from these classes. Means in this sense, if I want to use the discount property, then I need to inherit from CLS customer, then only I will be able to view the discount property, or else I won't be able to view the discount property. So if you want to ensure that you want to make visible your entity and the methods only in the hierarchical, or only in the inheritance hierarchy, or only through the generalization specialization relationship, at those moments only you will use the protected property. So the plus indicates the public property, the minus indicates that it's a private property or private method depending on where you show the notation in the class diagram, and the hash indicates a protected property. That means only the inherited classes or the child classes who inherit from this class can access the protected property. Definitely a single class cannot represent the whole module in a project. I mean to say, if suppose it's a customer maintenance project, then only customer class won't do. It's possible that the customer interacts with the invoice, or customer interacts with the printer object, you know. So definitely a single class will not do. There is always other classes will interact with other. Now one of the important thing is that a single class cannot represent the whole module in a project. So for example, we have defined a customer class. Definitely the customer class has to interact with other classes to fulfill the functionality. So it's possible that for example, in the video I have shown order class, which interacts with the payment class to achieve the full functionality, is saying that the order, once you place the order, it will use the payment class to do the payment. So a class itself cannot represent a system. It's basically the interaction between these classes represents a system. So definitely when you design your technical document, when you write your technical document, you'll definitely need to show interaction between the classes. And this interaction in UML is shown by using the arrow key.